this is how I imagine the earth was when God created it. It was only later that he embellished it. Human beings did their part too, and through the ages developed different visions of the Creator. The influence of the various prophets of God is reflected in the diversity of temples and other sacred places. Could there be a mysterious logic in the fact that a single spot in the Near East has been the birthplace of several world religions? Judaism, the law of God. This is where Moses revealed his prophecies and issued the Ten Commandments. To this day, people come to the ancient Wailing Wall to pray. Islam. The call to prayer in the mosque goes out and people come to bow down to worship God. Christianity. There is hardly a person on earth who has not heard of Calvary. Here, they mourn and glorify the Christ, who died here 2,000 years ago. Faithful to the ancient prophecies for many centuries, people here awaited the second coming of the Son of Man. They even calculated the time of his appearance. The Lord is Nigh, 1871. At about this time, the voice of a new prophet was indeed heard. He came from Persia, and his name was Baha'u'llah.
Сегодня Ноуруз справляется бахаистами. Это старый иранский праздник, который с давних времен, тысячелетия.
I learned about him in Moscow one spring when I found myself at an unusual New Year celebration.
О Боже, добрый ко всем, ты обо всех заботишься. Всем даешь приют, всем даруешь жизнь, всех наделил ты талантами и способностями, и все погружены в океан твоего милосердия. О Господи благой, объедини всех, да достигнут согласия религии, и да соединятся все народы в один народ, чтобы считать им друг друга одной семьей и целую землю единым домом всех.
They were Baha'is, followers of the teachings of Baha'u'llah. They had come to Moscow from Ashgabad, Berlin, Kazan, and even Alaska. I was astounded by these people's spiritual outlook. Mosafar Namdar, a Baha'i from Finland, suggested that I should get to know how the followers of Baha'u'llah lived in other countries. Through his efforts, Baha'is of other communities agreed to act as hosts to our film crew and to tell us about themselves. That is how this film came into being. God is one in all religions and for all peoples. This is the light for the whole of humanity. In Arabic, Baha'i means radiant light. This is the name the followers of Baha'u'llah's teachings took for themselves. God is one in all religions and for all people. There would hardly seem to be anything dangerous in such an idea, and yet it aroused the indignation of fanatics in Baha'u'llah's native land of Persia. Executions, persecution, and lifelong exile awaited the followers of the new faith. The Prophet himself, like all prophets, drained the cup of suffering in the torture cells of Tehran, Baghdad, Constantinople, and finally in the Holy Land. Akka was the place to which the most dangerous criminals were exiled, and it was here that the laws of the new faith were revealed.
The prophets and messengers of God have a single purpose, to direct mankind on to the straight path of truth. The purpose of their revelations has consisted in the education of the whole of mankind. The light radiated from these souls is the cause of the progress of the world and the development of the peoples.
Such holy words emerged from the dark walls and made their home in people's hearts. Gradually, the harsh regime of confinement was softened and prison was replaced by exile. Baha'u'llah's earthly life came to an end in this house in Baji. In the history of these teachings, I came across an intriguing connection with Russia. At that time, Russia was distinguished by a flourishing culture, and various people were engaged in seeking ancient, secret knowledge which had been lost. They were seeking for the meaning of life. They thirsted after communion with God. Leo Tolstoy's revelations disturbed people and aroused many souls from slumber. This great thinker knew about the Baha'i Faith and acknowledged that the Baha'i Faith is one of the most exalted and pure of religions. It is the most profound and most prophetic. The teaching aroused interest in Russia. Ali Akbar Furatan, known to the Baha'is as the Hand of the Cause of God, lived in Russia more than 60 years ago.
I was a boy, 9 years old, and there were 4,000 Baha'is in Ashgabad. When I was studying, it was the biggest center in Turkey. We had two schools, for men and women. I was studying there, and afterwards, I was a teacher myself. I taught them about Baha'u'llah. He teaches that we have to love everyone. Not only your country, your culture, but you have to love the whole of humanity.
What was happening then in Ishqabad seemed to confirm the words of Baha'u'llah. God has singled out for Russia a significance with which nothing can be compared. During the years of totalitarian rule, the Baha'i community in Russia shared the fate of all spiritual movements. The Baha'i Temple was profaned, later damaged by an earthquake, finally destroyed along with many other religious buildings. By the operation of some hidden logic, a monument to the philosopher-poet Maktum Kuli was erected on the site. In his poems, he wrote of a love for people which must be free from religious prejudice, and that soon a man would come who would help mankind through the power of love. The teachings which generate this unifying love were carried by the followers of Baha'u'llah from Russia into Europe, to Germany, where the largest community in Europe has taken shape.
My name is Ziyal Kazemzadeh. I was born in Ashgabat. My parents emigrated to Ashgabat. At the beginning of the 20th century, the Baha'is were put into prison. They closed the Baha'i centers, and many Baha'is escaped from Russia.
Are you surprised that Germany, with its culture and history, should have proved disposed to the new faith? But there is a reason for that. These people have gone through a great deal of suffering and rethinking. It is not easy to live with the burden of responsibility for the cruel wars unleashed by your forebears. But if people are capable of suffering, then they are capable of being transformed. For this reason, Europe's first temple, symbolizing the unifying love of people for one another, was built in Germany.
Und in dieses Land, in diese Umwelt, die einen der Tiefpunkte der gesamten menschlichen Zivilisation bedeutet.
The German community organized an international women's conference at which equality of men and women was affirmed. All problems must be resolved amicably, gently, wisely, not at the other person's expense, but through frank and loving consultation. Before reaching a decision, one seeks guidance from God. Prayer, together with meditation, leads to a profound immersion into one's own being and enlightenment. At first, I didn't find it easy to enter the temple of a faith that was new to me. I already knew that it had 9 entrances, symbols for the various world faiths known to us, for the believers of all religions, and that anyone might easily enter here and just as easily leave. I also knew that 9 is the highest single number, a symbol of unity, and felt drawn to become a part of that great unity.
Just as lesser living things have a sudden emergence into new and further life,
so for mankind also a critical state, a time of rebirth is at hand.
I heard Baha'is say Persia is the cradle of the new faith, Germany is like its head, and America is its arms and legs. And here I am in America. Democracy, a wealthy country. It looks so successful. I began my meetings with communities in Alaska. From early childhood, I had imagined the boundless space where Eskimos travel on dog sleds, a place where special people came, gold prospectors and adventurers. Barrow, the most northerly part of America. David Baumgartner shattered all my illusions about the people who live here.
Here, look at that. My parents became Baha'is, 40-some years ago now. And they became
His
Baha'is.
His parents were Baha'is
Southern
who came
US,
here from
right?
warm and beautiful
okay,
Florida.
Time,
he grew up here, became a Baha'i, and eventually married Carol, an Eskimo.
Alaska.
Their children have grown up here, so and the entire extended Florida. Family lives here in Alaska.
To help teach the faith in Alaska. That kind of like the early time of the Baha'i when everybody's watching us, seeing how is the Baha'i, what is the Baha'i like.
From them, I realized that Baha'i pioneers are not at all like missionaries. Baha'is do not actively proselytize in their efforts to attract other people to their faith. They simply live and work alongside other people, mindful that teaching through deeds is the most effective way to touch people's hearts. I learned from David that for several years their family tried hard to set an example to let people see what they did. After 3 or 4 years, their close friends also became Baha'is, and their community came into being. It is the northerlymost spiritual assembly in the world.
O my God, O thou forgiver of sins, bestower of gifts, dispeller of afflictions, verily, I beseech thee to forgive the sins of such as have abandoned the physical garment.
A community meeting looks and feels as though family members and close friends have gathered to celebrate. Everyone brings their children. I learned that the family is held in the highest esteem, that a strong and happy family is the basis of harmony in society. In simple words, it is the model of the future society. Baha'is gather together to associate with each other in a spirit of goodwill. At the beginning, there's always prayer. It seems to set the tone and acts as a kind of spiritual tuning fork for the people who have gathered.
Oh,
this faith brought to the indigenous population of the area, the Eskimos? Since the arrival of Western civilization, Eskimos have suffered the humiliation of seeing their own culture drowned in fire water. Life is given to us for serving others. For instance, the fire service needed volunteers in order to operate, and David worked as a fireman for 20 years. It was hard work. He even had to risk his life. But it was work that people needed, and he embraced it in a spirit of service.
Not enough money. And so her husband and Roy and I volunteered for 20 years.
I ask why Baha'is give such importance to the education of children.
Another thing,
if you want to do something, you
children.
Have to start
the
with the children, David answered. Education
here
is one of the most important activities.
Here.
So every day, special classes are held with the children in our community. And these children do better in school than all the others.
Here every morning on their school days. Before they go to school, you know, we get them together for classes here.
Good evening. This is the Glad Tidings, a program about the Baha'i Faith. The Glad Tidings is produced by the Baha'is of Barrow, and it's played over KBRW in Barrow, Alaska, every week. The Baha'is of Barrow are pleased to bring you this program about the Baha'i Faith. Wait. Today we have Manixuk Baumgartner and Davida Baumgartner and Joseph Saxton. And they'll be sharing
the
with
community
you the
does other practical work, a radio
Faith.
Station. They broadcast the weather report as well as other information the members of the community need. The children help with the programs. Eskimos are amazing people. They are like the most beautiful rose in the garden, says David. But what does the community really mean to the native people? Evelyn answered my question.
I am Evelyn Williams. I was born and raised in Barrow. I am Inupiaq. My Eskimo name is Ayalhok. I am married to a Tlingit Indian, and we live in southeastern Alaska. My boys are Tlingit and Inupiaq. I became a Baha'i about 1972. My life has been greatly affected by being a Baha'i in that a lot of the traditions of the native, of our culture, and what the Baha'i faith teaches are interrelated. You know, I was raised Presbyterian, and in the church they tell us, and in church service, how the days of the end would be. And one of the things that I asked about was the moon and the stars falling from the sky. Country count. I couldn't imagine how a star that was supposed to be so big. Baha'u'llah, when he came with the interpretations of the prophecies in the Bible. And those were meant to be that the clergy, that their powers would fall. At the time when Christ came, the mentality of the human race as a whole was very young. And so Jesus had to speak in parables. I asked about the devil. In the Baha'i faith, we are responsible for our actions. And we don't need to blame it on somebody.
Walter Austin is an Alaskan Indian elder. For 20 years, I was an alcoholic. I didn't understand where my life was heading. I was sinking. I was feeling worse and worse. In 1971, I became a Baha'i, and my life acquired a new direction.
I wasn't getting any better. I was getting worse. So in 1971, I became
indeed, in the community, he was able to find a new way of life. And now he calls himself a teacher of international fortune, a teacher of trust.
So now they said, well, how can I heal myself.
One can easily understand why the prohibition of alcohol is one of the teachings of the Baha'i Faith. The independent search for truth requires a sober understanding of reality.
Ignorance, prejudice, envy, jealousy, suspicion. I had to heal myself from all this, starting with anger.
Perhaps no other religion is so suited to the problems of modern man.
Many friends of mine are going back to their roots.
Whenever I see a globe, I immediately remember Terry and Gavin Reed. They have 9 children. 6 of them are adopted. Isn't this too much for the young couple? We always wanted a big family, said Gavin Reed. So after our 2 children were born, we decided to adopt someone. And gradually there appeared in their family 2 boys from India, 3 girls from Korea, James from Texas, and then their own child, the youngest, was born. Are the Reeds rich people who do this for charity? No, they live quite modestly by American standards.
Next person that we adopted was James, and he came from Texas, and that was some period of time before that happened, but he came also as a baby. And then we had another child of our own that we had ourselves as the last one.
In this family, every moment is filled with the loving attention of one person for another. They are not directly making their children into Baha'is. At 15, every person chooses whether to accept the responsibilities of an adult Baha'i. And if they want, they can go back to the family in which they were born, where they still may have sisters and brothers, perhaps even a mother. The choice of religion is left up to each individual and not made for him from birth. I found this astounding. This is the supreme level of freedom offered to man. I visited another community at the other end of America, in South Carolina. There, they traditionally grow white cotton and black tobacco, and traditional racial prejudices still linger on. Here I learned the story of a union of 2 loving hearts, Ursula and Moses Richardson. In January 1979, I came to the Lewis Gregory Institute, said Ursula. I wanted to get to know the Baha'is of these parts and learn a bit more about the faith. There are usually a lot of people gathered here to do just that, and I don't know when we first had the idea of getting married. For Baha'is, the permission of one's parent is a major condition for marriage, so that afterwards there should be no cause for discord in the family. Therefore, the young couple first made a trip to Germany to receive the permission of Ursula's parents. There were no problems, until they asked Moses' mother, who was absolutely against the idea. She was afraid of her son marrying a white woman of a new faith. In those parts, Baha'is were not immediately understood and accepted.
It was interesting because I've never had experience about racial prejudice, or I thought I wasn't even prejudiced. And so when Moses' mother at first was hesitant, I was very surprised because I didn't understand that also black people might not be too crazy to have a person from a different race. when I became a Baha'i, I believed in the oneness of God and the oneness of religion and the oneness of mankind. And then I caught myself that I said it, but it wasn't really all in my heart. And
they were even physically attacked, so Moses' family had good reason to worry. Really, but eventually conciliation, trust, and love won over.
And I realized that, you know, we all have the same needs, regardless of where we live. We all want to be loved, we want to be respected, we want for our children to be happy and lead productive lives, and we don't want to have the fear of war and all these kinds of things.
If the heart is pure and the mind free from prejudice, the earnest seeker of truth will not fail to recognize the divine glory in whatsoever temple it may become manifest.
Every religion has its symbols expressing the most important concepts and ideas. The cross is the symbol of Christianity. The chakra is the symbol of Buddhism. The crescent moon and star are the symbols of Islam. On the wall of the Baha'i Temple, you can see all of these symbols. And of course, the Baha'i's greater symbol, the nine-pointed star, a symbol of unity.
My God, this is the passionate desire and prayer of thy servant, to see the friends from the west and the friends from the east gathered together, and the inhabitants of this world united in goodwill, like unto the members of a single society, like unto the leaves of one tree and the rays of one sun.
In New York City, I saw the United Nations building and realized that a major step towards unity was taken when the UN was formed. The Baha'i world community supports the UN with all its available resources. But the time has come to take the next step towards unity. Learned a lot about the life of the Baha'is, and yet I felt that I had only seen the surface, the tip of the iceberg. What lay below? We still had to meet the communities of South America in Peru and Bolivia. Legend has it that the Amerindian peoples were the first race on Earth when Europe and part of Asia were still underwater. I thought I could see in these faces the inscrutable melancholy of the ancient races. What mysteries and sacred wisdom must be embedded in their genetic memory through eons of priestly rituals and sacred practices? For them, like others, all the while between God and man, there stood the high priest, also a man.
Mm-hmm.
In the Baha'i Faith, there is no such intermediary between God and mankind. There are no sacraments to be performed, such as christening or confession, to obtain the forgiveness of sins. This was unsettling to me, and I began searching deeper, trying to find the essential attributes of religion. These people live differently and seem ready at any time to meet death. And I noticed another thing. Their concept of the soul embodies basic conceptions of the Baha'i Faith. Just as a child not yet born has the limbs and organs he will require in this life, so the spiritual qualities of every individual are hidden deep within. Love, compassion, tolerance. The development of these qualities constitutes the fundamental goal in this life and preparation of the soul for the hereafter.
En adoración el reino de tus nombres.
It would seem that Spanish conquistadors who brought European culture here destroyed much of the rich Andean civilization. However, European domination failed to change their profound spiritual relationship to life. For the Quechua and Aymara Baha'is, just what is the relationship between the people of the ancient race and modern-day civilization? The Baha'i pioneers who came to these parts learned the local language. Radio Baha'i Titicaca broadcasts from 4 in the morning to 9 in the evening, airing programs on the best way of tending a field, the most rational way to run a household, how to cure a sick child, and together with all of this, meditation on the purpose of life, on the soul of man, and elements to nurture spiritual growth.
Atardecer Collavino. En el cartel en calle hasta Masicuna, curan jepe sumasta cusiricunches. May mantachos kankuna pesuirim siwang ke tuku hiranting yakta kunamanta. No haikupi sa chay kamami, cherimus kaiko kay Radio Baha'i del Lago Titicaca a chay manta.
I became a Baha'i because I understood the beautiful principles of the religion, the equality of men and women, the harmony of science and religion, a universal language among brothers. I came of my own will. No one forced me. When I learned of this faith, I myself began to change, and a whole new world opened up to me. Baha'u'llah is the new Messiah of our age. I am convinced of that. I am convinced that there will be soon peace throughout the world. It will come. I believe that.
The community has put a great deal of effort into organizing its spiritual feast every 19 days in this harsh region. What beautiful festive costumes I saw. And there was folk music. and a miracle took place before my very eyes. The melancholy faces were illuminated by a radiant smile of joy. At the feast, I met the pioneer William Baker. I came to South America with my family to teach the Baha'i Faith, but after a while, I became worried. When you teach, you promise something. Religion teaches that there will be a better world, and I felt that talking was not enough. I had to do something, something concrete.
I became conscious that really there's...
People were leaving land here. They said their fathers and grandfathers had spoiled the meadows, the valleys, and the rivers. But this was their land, and we had to try to restore the damage. And so I stayed on to work here.
I really felt that it was time we began working toward that better world.
The rector of Nuru University in Bolivia sets himself some very interesting goals.
In order to become enlightened, a person must pass through several stages. In the first place, he must attempt to answer the questions, who am I? Why did I come into this world? What can I do for the good of other people? Only when he has grasped this can he be educated. Electronic equipment can serve this main purpose. The spiritual aspect, said the rector, is not taken into account in materialistic societies. Spiritual development is far more than simply going to church, and it can't be achieved by acquiring information. The longest and most difficult journey is the one from the brain to the heart, to the soul.
Exigen a la universidad que se dirige a diferentes estratos sociales hacia diferentes razas y pueblos y que trata de responder a las necesidades de grandes mayorías.
Religion and science are two wings upon which man's intelligence can soar into the heights with which the human soul can progress. It is not possible to fly with one wing alone. Should a man try to fly with the wing of religion alone, he would quickly fall into the quagmire of superstition, whilst on the other hand, with the wing of science alone, he would also make no progress.
Temples of incredible antiquity have been preserved in India. And alongside the grandeur of the past, a Baha'i temple has been built. The temple's architect, Faribor Saba, said that its doors are open to the people of all religions.
Baha'i house of worship is a place that is supposed to be open to all the people of all the religions, and it should be a place that everybody from all castes, all races, and all religions feel that this is his own temple. He can go in and he will be comfortable. He can sit and meditate. And as you know, in India, where we have so many religions and so many symbolism, it's very important that a temple should be, really should appeal to the people. Otherwise, if, for example, you build a temple which is like anywhere near a Hindu temple, the Buddhists and Muslims and Christians won't go in it. And I found, after lots of traveling in India, I found that really the only symbol that you can have, which somehow covers all of these aspects, is the lotus. Hindus, they believe Brahma, creator, was born in a lotus. Lord Buddha says that you have to be like a lotus which grows in mud, in dirty atmosphere, but it remains above it clean and pure. The same is with the other religions like in India, like Jainism, Christianity, and Islam. So it's appealing to the heart of all the people of all the religion. And I thought when they come to this temple, they feel that this is somewhere they had seen it before. Maybe they had dreamed about it before. Now they see it in reality.
Be ye as the fingers of one hand, the members of one body. The light of unity is so powerful that it can illuminate the whole earth. The tabernacle of unity hath been raised. Regard ye not one another as strangers. Ye are all the fruits of one tree, the leaves of one branch.
And here I am in Haifa, in Israel. This is the spiritual and administrative center of the Baha'i world community. It was here that Baha'u'llah spent his last years. His followers and friends have preserved and beautified this mansion at Baji, where he passed his final days on earth.
Praise be to God that thou hast attained. Thou hast come to see a prisoner and an exile. We desire but the good of the world and the happiness of the nations. Yet they deem us a stirrer up of strife and sedition, worth of bondage and banishment. That all nations should become one in faith and all men as brothers. That the bonds of affection and unity between the sons of men should be strengthened. That diversity of religion should cease and differences of race be annulled. What harm is there in this? Yet so it shall be. These fruitless strifes, these ruinous wars shall pass away, and the most great peace shall come.
Anyone who accepts this revelation may enter here.
O Son of Spirit, the best beloved of all things in my sight is justice. Turn not away therefrom, if thou desirest me, and neglect it not, that I may confide in thee. By its aid thou shalt see with thine own eyes, and not through the eyes of others, and shalt know of thine own knowledge, and not through the knowledge of thy neighbor. Ponder this in thy heart, how it behooveth thee to be. Verily, justice is my gift to thee, and the sign of my loving kindness. Set it then before thine eyes.
The Universal House of Justice. How wonderful the words sound. On a basis of concord and harmony, the world community of Baha'is elects 9 people to form the crowning institution of the world order of Baha'u'llah, the cornerstone of a unified world family. And now we are back in Moscow in the spring. Russia, which played its part at the beginning of the faith's development, is once again showing interest. I can sense that. Movements are begun by individuals, but as history has clearly shown, if the message is timely, the same people who once stoned the prophet eventually follow in his footsteps. At this critical historical juncture, we face a choice between a bloody confusion of exclusive fanaticism or the spiritual solidarity of every human on earth. To be a part of the single, integrated family of humankind surely is no small thing. Is this not true?